Your Grace, on behalf of the Christian of St. Nicholas Church, I want to welcome you to our church.
Your Grace, we at St. Nicholas Church welcome you to Philadelphia today. We have two occasions. The first for you to serve the Divine Liturgy and the consecration of the Holy Elements, that all of those who will be going to communion will be uplifted in fulfilling the command of the Lord that they partake of the body and blood of Christ so they could inherit the eternal kingdom. The second thing we will be doing is going down to the river, and we have prayers there for the blessing of the river, that by your prayers that the evil spirits will be dispelled and that the rivers will be cleansed and any of the living creatures therein would be able to multiply so that we would be able to sustain ourselves and our community. And most of all, we here at St. Nicholas welcome you, especially because we feel that whatever we do is ultimately for you. And if there are some things that we do to help to enhance the growth of the church, to enhance the growth of the our parishioners and their spiritual uplifting and benefit, that this is that much better for you as the bishop, who ultimately is the one who holds all of them in his hands.
Thank you. Immortal, have mercy on us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages. Amen. O most holy Trinity, have mercy on us. Lord, cleanse us from our sins. Master, pardon our transgressions. Holy One, visit and heal our infirmities for the name's sake. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lord, have mercy. 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 Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages. Amen. Come, let us worship God our King. Come, let us worship and fall down before Christ our King and our God. Come, let us worship and fall down before Christ himself our King and our God. Hear a just cause, O Lord, attend to my cry. Give ear to my prayer from lips free of deceit. From thee let my vindication come, let thy eyes see the right. If thou triest my heart, if thou visitest me by night, if thou testest me, thou wilt find no wickedness in me. My mouth does not transgress with regard to the works of man. By the word of thy lips I have avoided the ways of the violent. My steps have held fast to thy paths, my feet have not slipped. I call upon thee, for thou wilt answer me, O God. Incline thy ear to me, hear my words. Wondrously show thy steadfast love, O Savior, of those who seek refuge from their adversaries at thy right hand. Keep me as the apple of the eye, hide me in the shadow of thy wings from the wicked who despoil me, my deadly enemies who surround me. They close their hearts to pity with their mouths, they speak arrogantly. They track me down, now they surround me. They set their eyes to cast me to the ground. They are like a lion eager to tear as a young lion lurking in ambush. Arise, O Lord, confront them, overthrow them. Deliver my life from the wicked by the sword. From men by thy hand, O Lord, for man whose portion is in the life of the world. May their belly be filled with what thou hast stored up for them. May their children have more than enough. May they leave something over to their babes. As for me, I shall behold thy face in righteousness. When I awake, I shall be satisfied with beholding thy form. To thee, O Lord, I lift up my soul, O God, in thee I trust. Let me not be put to shame, let not my enemies exult over me. Yea, let none that wait for thee be put to shame. Let them that be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know thy ways, O Lord, teach me thy true path. Lead me in thy truth and teach me, for thou art the God of my salvation. For thee I wait all the day long. Be mindful of thy mercy, O Lord, and of thy steadfast love, for they have been a fault from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to thy steadfast love, remember me for thy goodness' sake, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord, therefore he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. Oh, the paths of the Lord are of steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies. For thy name's sake, O Lord, pardon my guilt, for it is great. Who is the man that fears the Lord? He will instruct in the way that he should choose. He himself shall buy the prosperity, and his children shall possess the land. The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he makes known to them his covenant. My eyes are ever toward the Lord, for he will pluck my feet out of the net. Turn thou to me, and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. Relieve the troubles of my heart, and bring me out of my distress. Consider my affliction and my trouble, forgive all my sins. Consider how many of my foes, and with what violent hatred they hate me. Go forward my life and deliver me, let me not be put to shame, for I take refuge in thee. May integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for thee. Redeem Israel, God, out of all his troubles. Have mercy on me, O God, according to thy steadfast love, according to thy abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee, thee only have I sinned, and done that which is evil in thy sight, so that if thou art justified in thy sentence, and blameless in thy judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward being. Therefore teach me wisdom in thy secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Fill me with joy and gladness. Let the bones which thou hast broken rejoice. Hide thy face from thy sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of thy salvation, uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach the transgressors thy ways, and sinners will return to thee. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, thou God of my salvation. My tongue will sing aloud of thy deliverance.
No. spoke even in the first tone, let thy mercy, O Lord, be upon us, as we have set our hope on thee.
You descended. Galilee of the Gentiles. The people which sat in darkness are great light, and to them which sat in treason and shadow of death, light is sprung up. From that time Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Dearly beloved, on this Sunday, after the feast of the baptism of our Lord, we call it the Sunday of Illumination. We know that St. John the Baptist went out and he was preparing the people for one that was made who was to come after him, Christ would be the light of the world. And we know that not only did St. John preach this, but actually it happened. And just as St. John was preaching, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand, the very first sermon of our Lord, the Savior Jesus Christ, carried the very same message. We must remember that it was some 800 years before the coming of Christ that the prophet Isaiah, seeing that the people were living in complete darkness, seeing the need of the prophets or even the apostles at that time to do anything to change the people themselves, it was here that in the vision he was told that the Lord would come and be that light for all people, that he would come into the world. It was 800 years later that that light did appear, Christ himself. See that even St. John the Baptist, that which he preached was something that was very temporary, because he was reminding man that he was living in a world of sin, asking him to repent. However, when Christ came into the world, it automatically became that New Testament. And he spoke and he preached of nothing more than eternal life itself. No longer was it temporary, but instead that we had the possibility to gain that eternal life, to enter into the kingdom of heaven. And we know that many things have taken place in these nearly 2,000 years since Christ was on the earth. We know that the first thing that he did before he even started his mission was to be baptized of John. And then his first sermon was to preach, repent, for the kingdom of God. And yet, even with all of this, we see that within the world itself, so many things have taken place. There have been so many new inventions. There have been many cures, even for diseases. And perhaps even these are the things that possibly cause man to think within himself, do we really need the light of Christ? There are those people, and perhaps we are even numbered among them, that no longer really place all of our faith, all of our trust in the Lord, but we think because we are leading a good life here on this earth, we think that because we see all of these new inventions that take place and making life itself sometimes easier for ourselves, we begin to trust in these things rather than trusting in God. And yet we know what the answer is. We needed the light of Christ at that time. We need it today, and we will need it tomorrow. There is no way that we can live unless we are going to have faith in Christ himself. Unless we are going to believe in him, unless we will love him, unless we will imitate him in all the things that we ever do. We know that as we go through life itself, it is so easy to give in to the temptations that surround us. It is so easy for us to really place trust in other things other than God. we want to give it to someone else, causing us at that particular moment to think that we really do not need the light of Christ. No matter where we turn, we see nothing and we hear nothing but bad news. We hear those people that are starving. We hear of those people that have died innocently because of terrorists. We are constantly reminded that if in a split second someone would push a button for that nuclear war, and all would come to an end. And even with all of this, sometimes we really hesitate in turning to Christ himself. And we see this every day of our life. We see it in our own homes, sometimes with ourselves. There are moments that actually we're willing to stand before God and to say that absolutely I don't follow you, I really don't love you the way that I should. I place my trust in other things rather than in you. We know that regardless of what the suffering may be, regardless of what the illness may be, that even though that here on earth we can be given some form of comfort, there's always something that replaces. Even the worst of diseases, they bring out a cure, and all of a sudden there's another disease that we must contend with. There can be one form of suffering in our community, we take care of that, then all of a sudden there is something else. The only answer and the only good news is really in Christ himself, in all of his teachings. These are the things that absolutely we are called upon to follow, to be obedient to all of his commandments, to all of his teachings. We give in so quickly to everything else. We know that absolutely those communities wherein they have turned completely against the teachings of Christ, wherein they don't want to follow that good and that perfect example, we know that very quickly even those communities themselves disappear. However, where they continue to believe and to place their trust in him, he is there to give all the strength that is absolutely necessary to continue to live. We have all witnessed that how many times? How many times throughout the day or even at the end of the day we felt that we just could not go on even another minute? Whether it was because we were concerned about the number of bills that we had to pay, whether it was because of some form of illness that we ourselves were going through, or one of our loved ones, or we felt that there was just so much suffering even in our community and we were afraid that we could not even live for the rest of the night in that house, not knowing what would take place. And yet, as long as we are willing to take even a few seconds and to do nothing more than speak to God and show him that we love him, and especially that we want to imitate his Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, all of a sudden we don't need anyone else. Don't need anyone else, whether it be in our household or outside the household. We have been given the strength to be able to go and to endure all things, and we get up in the morning and we say, well, my goodness, we give all that courage. And look how quickly it has, and how joyful, how peaceful even we are at this particular moment. We know that if we go to a doctor for any form of illness whatsoever, in his own wisdom prescribes a prescription, asking us to follow it, and perhaps even offers his own prayer that it would be helpful, beneficial, bring peace and comfort to us. And many times if we take it, we know that a change comes, even if it's the ailment itself. However, if we ignore what the doctor gives us, what he prescribed, we really can't blame him, we have to blame ourselves if we don't follow any codes. And it's the same thing that Christ, the greatest physician of all, we are to turn to him every day of our life. And just because we feel that he doesn't give us what we We really cannot and must not ever blame him, but we can only blame ourselves for not being obedient to that which he prescribed. That very first instruction, that very first lesson that he gave, wherein he said, repent for the kingdom of God is at hand, was a prescription that we are to follow every day of our life. If we try to see how much it works, regardless of what suffering we may endure within our own household or within the community itself, as long as we are willing to look to ourselves first, cast off every evil that may be there, every sinful act, and really do nothing more than repent and to show God that we love him, that we want to be his obedient children, he will permit that change to begin to take place. And he will even allow us that while we are still here on this earth, to come to know and to live and to be with Christ as a preparation for entrance into the kingdom of heaven. We all have a task that we must accomplish. With all of Christ's teachings, we know that even the disciples of St. John the Baptist, those that were very closest to him, they already saw that really the mission of St. John was coming to an end. He had fulfilled that which he was called to do, to go out and to prepare the way. He continued to baptize some more people, which really everything ended there because he was already part of the Old Testament. However, with the coming of Christ, Christ took over and he is to reign in the lives of all. And we know that just as those disciples of St. John, they immediately began to follow Christ. They became his apostles. And then all we have to do is look into the Holy Scriptures and we will see the great number of people that lived in darkness, that saw Christ regardless of where he was, that immediately they knew that he was Christ the Savior. They began to change their lives and they began to follow him. And we know that Christ even gave us an example, wherein he told us that we also are to go out and to imitate. Never using force, never once trying to demand or force anyone to really go out and to imitate him. But he asked that it be an act of sacrificial love, wherein he said, and he killed, he who will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow. He leaves it all up to us. He tells us what we can gain if we will follow him. He tells us what we will learn for ourselves if we don't follow him. And this is why he told each and every one of us that we must grow up, having been baptized and been burned into his body, that we must go out and preach and teach his word. There are still so many people. It's really faith. They don't need Christ. They don't need Christ. Yes, very sadly, we must admit that not only here in this church this morning, but in many churches throughout this country and throughout this world, there are so many empty spaces, so many that are empty that should be filled. And perhaps they are empty because even those people feel that they don't need the light of Christ. We all know that we need the light of Christ, and they need the light of Christ. If we are his children, if we are to walk in his footsteps, then we must do everything within our power that we will not be satisfied just seeing people walk in darkness. Whether it be someone within our own family, one of our friends, or that stranger that is just searching, that person that is walking in darkness and is undergoing some form of sorrow, some form of unhappiness. It is not enough for us to just merely believe in the feast, the baptism of our Lord, but instead we must accept him as our Savior, and we must go out and imitate him in all that we do. That command that he gave, that instruction that he gave, wherein It must be foremost in our minds. And we will see that as we begin to repent, as we begin to walk in the direction of Christ, that absolutely we will never, never walk alone. First of all, He will be with us to give us the strength to accomplish all kinds of things. And then we will receive that added strength, that added joy, that as we come in the midst of others, they will be able to see the light of Christ within us. And they will not want to leave that light, but instead they also want to become a part of that light. And together we will gain that joy that we all seek, and that is entrance into the kingdom of heaven, both now and ever, and unto ages of ages. the apostles, archbishops, bishops, priests, deacons, monastics, all those ordained into the holy orders, may the Lord God from him in his kingdom always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. This country, the President of the United States, and all civil authorities and the armed forces everywhere, may the Lord God from him in his kingdom always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. The bound his holy temple, the church council, all those who worship, sing, and learn therein, may the Lord God from him in his kingdom always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. Thy afflicted servants, Reader Alexander, Reader Andrew, Anthonist, Anastasia, Barbara, Karen, together with all of the afflicted this holy temple, may the Lord God remember in his kingdom, always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. Thy newly departed servants, Archpriest Afanasi, Fecla, together with all of the departed's life in this holy temple to be commemorated today, may the Lord God remember in his kingdom, always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. You and our Orthodox Christians, may the Lord God remember in his kingdom, always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. Thou art the kingdom, may the Lord God remember in his kingdom, always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Thank you.
Therefore, I pray thee, have mercy upon me, forgive my transgression, but voluntary, worthy of thee, knowledge and ignorance, and make me worthy to partake thy magnificent mysteries and to remission of sins, the angel, soul, and body. Amen. Of thy mystical supper, Son of God, accept me today's communion from our mouth, speak thy mysteries to thine enemies. Neither will I give thee a kiss, as it is like the thief, I confess in the memory, O Lord, in thy kingdom. Not unto judgment, but condemnation, because the Lord is the Lord, to heal you of soul and body. Amen. God, cleanse me of sin, and have mercy upon me. God, you achieve the indignation of your community, of God, cleanse me of sinner, and have mercy.
those who bless thee, and sanctify those who trust in thee, save thy people and bless thy inheritance. Preserve the fullness of thy church, sanctify those who love the beauty of thy house. Glorify them, return by thy divine power, and forsake us not. We'll put our hope in thee, give peace to thy world, to thy churches, to thy priests, to all those in civil authority, and to all thy people, for every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from thee, the Father of lights. And unto thee we ascribe glory, thanksgiving, and worship to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
Sunday, the illumination, Sunday after the baptism of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It was the decision of the Holy Synod to present you with the real cross. Today I have great joy to present it to you, and especially a great joy because it comes to you as a gift from your sacred cross. We pray that indeed, the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will continue to bless you, lead you, and guide you, that you will continue laboring for the building up of His church, that indeed, for your ultimate example, you all, self and ultimate salvation.
Archpriest, Herman, all of the way of the day, and we deserve them all.
As you're coming to kiss the cross, I first want to thank you for the gift of this cross. And as you come by, you can see it. And I'll bring it downstairs. We're going to have our luncheon down in the church hall. So if you would just go downstairs and get yourself seated so that when we complete our consumption of the chalice and so forth here, we will come right down and we can get into our dinner. We'd like to leave about 1:30 from here, drive over to Penn's Landing by the museum for the blessing of water. We'd like to have that go on somewhere around 2 o'clock. And after we bless the water, for those who want to come back, we're going to leave all the food and everything here. We can come back and you'll have an opportunity to talk with the bishop or with our other guests. These are the things we have scheduled. And the last thing I want to mention is that I will be giving all of you a call for Blessing the Homes this week. I would be going every day during this week, and hopefully by next Sunday we should have all of the homes blessed and the house blessing completed.